life on the cross at Calvary, and he hung there and died, went into a grave, rose on the third day. Conquered it for you and for me, and victory is in the name of the Lord, because salvation is in the name of the Lord. Amen. Listen to me. This man had faith, but sometimes in life, our faith is weak. Our faith is tired. Our faith doesn't feel like it can get there. And we need somebody to come along who'll get in agreement with what God wants to do, praise God, to the point that they'll carry us where we cannot go by ourselves. Amen. The Bible says he was born of four on that stretcher. Can you imagine, my friend, the conversation that was going on between this man and these four on the way to where Jesus was? I can hear him saying in my mind's eye, hey, where we going? What y'all up to? Where y'all carrying me? And I can hear my friend talking back to him and telling him, listen to me, you got to tell that one that's weak in faith. You got to tell that one that's struggling to believe. Today, you got an appointment with God. Today, we're taking you to the one who can walk on water. We're taking you to the one who made the blind see. We're taking you to the one who spoke to the wind and the waves, and they obeyed. Praise God. You need to speak life and hope and expectation into the spirit, praise God, so that faith can be stirred up, so that when they get there, they can get what they need, praise God.
Lord,
he needed it. He needed it. So much so that they had become desperate to get it. Listen to me. They didn't settle along the way. Listen to me. They had that man stretcher born of four on each corner of that bed or that couch or that blanket, whatever they were toting him on. When each one had a corner. Friend, I wonder today, my friend, it's no wonder that people can't get what they need, because somebody come along and take up a corner and walk a few paces and drop it and say, well, that's more than I can do. That's more than I got. I can't sacrifice that much. I can't. That's too much to cost. I'm too tired. I got something else to do. And they turn their back and walk away and leave that person right smack down in the middle of the road of life, and they still don't have what they need, praise God. The worst thing you can do is to pick up a corner and say, I'm taking you to the Lord, and not go all the way. The worst thing you can do is to lay it down somewhere along the way and not get them to Jesus, praise God. It's not enough just to get into the house. It's not enough just to get him in the proximity. It's not enough to just get close, praise God. These four men was desperately determined to get him to Jesus, praise God. The Bible says in Luke's Gospel chapter 5 and verse 17 that as the Lord was in this house on that day, that because the Lord was in the house, that the power of the Lord was present to heal. Hey. He said the power of the Lord was present to heal. But this hadn't turned into a healing service yet. This hadn't turned into a service where God would demonstrate his power and receive all the glory, because the man who was laying on his feet and had a sickle of palsy was yet to be raised up to walk in the newness of life. Oh, but as Jesus preached the word unto them, the Bible said that they couldn't get in. They tried to get in.
Preach.
Oh, this is the church. They tried to get in. They couldn't get in. The door was blocked. The windows were full. I can see them going around the house. and looking for a way to get to Jesus. Listen to me. Whenever the traditional way was blocked, they chose to go the non-traditional way. Whenever the conventional way was blocked, they chose to go the non-conventional way. Whenever the way that you usually go and come is blocked, it will be determined by you how bad you want to get to Jesus, thank God, as to whether you'll go another way, thank God. Listen to me. If you got out of your car, come in this place this morning, sat down in a pew, and blessed God was hoping for 3 songs of sermon, that you could get up and go, you ain't no different than most of them that was in that house that day. They wasn't there to get a word. They wasn't there to hear a word. They were just there because the Bible said that they were scribes and they were sitting in the house. You know what they were doing? What good religious people do? Sit. Good religious people sit. They sit and they soak. They sit and they stew. Hey. They either sit happy or they sit mad. They either sit glad or they sit sad. One or the other, praise God. But they do a good job of sitting, praise God. So good that they would not get up and move out the way so that they could bring a man who was sick of the palsy on a bed, a stretcher, and get him to Jesus. Can you imagine those 4 men say, hey, we got to get him in your... Oh, man, I ain't got time for you. Jesus preaching a good sermon up in here, and we don't need the likes of you to come up in and interrupt what Jesus is doing. Because all that's what good religious people say. That's what good religious people want to say. Oh, we don't need all that up in here. Jesus is up in here teaching. Everything's going good, and then you have to show up. Then you have to come. Listen to me, nobody in that house would give up their position, would give up their thought, their space, back out so they could come in. Nobody. That blows my mind. That's just how self-absorbed we are in being there in the crowd, blending in, fitting in, praise God. We got our spot, and you can't have my spot, because I'm the third generation to sit on this pew, praise God. Ain't nobody else going to sit here but me and my family. And you keep them that need something from the Lord from getting whatever God has come to give. Amen? Listen to me. Whenever they couldn't get in the door, the Bible says they went up on the roof and began to tear the tiling in Luke Gospel chapter 5 off of the roof. Now listen to me. They weren't just tearing one tile off to look in, praise God. They were tearing a big old pile of tiles off in order to lower this man down at the feet of Jesus, praise God. Listen to me. You say, preacher, I've done all I can do. I can't do no more. I went. I carried him as far as I could go. I tried to get in. I couldn't get in. I don't know what else to do. I've done all I can do. Let me ask you something. Have you tore the roof off? Have you tore the roof off? Because, bless God, there's a way to get there if you really want to get there, praise God. You might not go by the way of the tradition of men, praise God. You might not go by the way that everybody else got there. But, bless God, when you get there, you'll know that you're there, praise God. Oh, nobody has to tell you. Because Jesus is there, ready to meet his need. Amen. Listen to me, Jesus. Listen to me. I don't know what God's will for your life is, but I know what God's will for this man was. And it was that he not stay sick of the palsy, praise God. It was God's will that he be healed, praise God. You know how I know? Jesus healed. That's how I know. Because if it hadn't Peter's feet, I can see Jesus looking up at that hole. I can see Jesus smiling. I can almost hear him laughing, praise God. Looking up at a stretcher coming down from the air at his feet, praise God. And there he is. And Jesus looks back up at the hole, and there's four faces all over that hole looking down.
Come on, brother.
Look at that. To see what Jesus is going to do. Because they have gone with him as far as they could go.
Amen.
Bless God. They did everything that they could do, praise God. They did whatever it took to get this man to Jesus, praise God. Because they realized that they couldn't help him. They realized that they couldn't heal him. They realized that it would take Jesus to fix what was wrong in his life. Amen. Listen to me. I see him there, and they have my eyeball. There's a big old eyeball. Look at that. Because they have come with expectation. You know what Jesus said? Look, when he saw their faith. You know why he said that? Because their faith tore a hole in the roof. Because their faith didn't turn around and go back home. Because their faith did whatever it took, and their faith wouldn't settle somewhere along the way, praise God. Because their faith meant to get him to the Lord, praise God. Listen to me, it was their faith that Jesus saw. But the man laying at Jesus' feet, listen to me. This is what I don't understand today. As the church, the body of Christ, God's moving us forward with a vision in the 21st century to be the church that he called us to be. He's called us to be the church of the living God. A church that serves a God who's not a dead God, but a live God. The one with all power in his hand. The one, my friend, who got up from the dead on the third day, rose in victory, and he rose in power. He got up with the keys of the kingdom of death and hell. Therefore, my friend, he has all authority, and he has given that authority to us as the people of God. And if we would be filled with the Spirit of God, we would know the power of God.
Amen.
The power of God. The power of God was there to heal on that day, because Jesus was there on that day. And anytime you find yourself in the presence of the Lord, there's the power from God to demonstrate his healing, his glory, his salvation, his works, his wonders, his miracles, for God, his signs. Whatever God wants to do, he will do. But when we find ourselves in the presence of the Lord, listen to me, I don't need not one more ounce of religion.
Amen.
That, give me that old time religion, you can have it. I don't want it, you can keep it. I don't want religion. I want a fresh infusion of the Spirit of the living God. I want God to pour out like he did on the day of Pentecost. If they preach it, that won't ever happen again. Bless God, you can have your personal Pentecost. You can have a Pentecost right here in the house of the Lord. I'm looking for God to fill his saints. I'm looking for a state and a place of overflow. I'm looking, bless God, for the gifts and the anointing of the Holy Ghost to rise up within this body. God is taking us to places that people have needs, praise God. They got needs, praise God. Why is it that the church is comfortable and satisfied to sit and wait for somebody to escape the enemy camp, come running through the doors of the church and say, I need the Lord? Why is it? Bless God. He said, put on the full armor of God. to you with a silver platter and say, I think this belongs to you. I didn't mean to take it. I'm supposed to give it back, and I want you to have it. The enemy ain't gonna do that. He's not gonna do that. David had to get up from Ziklag and go get what was stolen away from him. And if you want it, bless God, you're going to have to fight for it. Amen. You're going to have to get up from where you at. If you are mine, you can sit in the ashes. You can sit in the ruins. You can have the smell of smoke, pray God. But if you want what God has for you, you got to go get it. Amen. The enemy ain't bringing it back. You got to storm the gates of hell. Bless God, people, I need a word from the Lord. Bless God, you don't need another word from the Lord. How many words has God given you? How many times has God spoke to you? How many times has God said go? How many times has God said do this? How many times has God opened a door that you wouldn't step through? How many times? You know, the people who are desperate for God, the people who are desperate for God, are the people who need something from the Lord. They need something from God. Until you really need the Lord, you don't know what it means to seek out the face of God.
Amen.
Until you really need the Lord, you don't know what it means to be like a deer that panteth after the waters, like soul thirsting and thirsteth after thee, O God. Until you need the Lord. Listen to me. You know how a preacher knows somebody needs the Lord? Whenever a preacher starts preaching the word of God and God begins to speak in the house of the Lord, then people are locked in. Then people right there, they are locked in to what God's saying. They are looking for the Lord to speak to their heart. You know the ones who ain't looking for a word from God? Them's the ones, my friend, that start taking the Bible and they start reading and flipping over. They start reading somewhere we ain't even at. Thinking about something we ain't even on. They get the songbook, start going through the songbook, see which song. Which song. They pick up the song, they start going through the text. I don't even read that. Delete that. I don't mean none of that. That's what they do. They trim their toenails in the house of the Lord. Bless God, they do. They trim their toenails in the house of the Lord. Bless God, get ready before you come to the house of the Lord. Bless God, if you got to trim your toenails, praise God, do that at home. Amen. Ain't something else to do in the house of the Lord. Seek God with all thy heart. Run into the presence of the Lord. Find God where you at. Bless God. Did you bring anybody this morning to God who has a need? Did you bring anything or anybody in the house of the Lord that needs the Lord? The Bible said they brought him to the Lord. They brought him. Did anybody come with you this morning that need to be saved? Did anybody come with you this morning that needs a touch from God? Did anybody come with you this morning, bless God, that needs the peace of God that passes all understanding? Did you bring anything to an altar today that you need God to lose and to set free, praise God? Is there anybody that needs deliverance? Bless God, you got to speak to the enemy, because there is, my friend, a spirit that's creeping up out of hell that says, just settle right where you're at. It ain't bad as it used to be. It's a little better than most. And you can just settle right there. You go ahead and settle. You're going to miss what God has for you. You're going to miss what God has for you. Y'all come on. The Bible says that this man, the Bible says that when Jesus, he knew what they was thinking in their heart. Immediately, he said unto them, which is easier to say, son, my sins be forgiven thee, or rise up and walk. He said, but so that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power to forgive sins on the earth, he told the man that was sick of the palsy, rise, take up thy bed, and walk. Can I want you to understand one thing? when Jesus spoke to that man, he called him son. We don't even know his name. We don't even know who his daddy was. Come on, man. We don't even know who he was. We don't know where he came from. But Jesus called him son. Hey, Jesus, my friend, became a father to the fathers right there in that moment. Jesus gave him an identity before he ever forgave him of his sins and before he ever healed his body, praise God. He just went ahead and called him son. You know why? Because God is able to speak those things that are not as though they were. Because God knew what he was going to do, and he knew the faith of the man to receive what it is that God came to give, praise God. Yes. Jesus knew that there was faith there. Yes. Listen to me. He did an inward work before he did an outward work. He said, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Oh, right there in that moment. In that moment. Jesus reached in to wash his sins away. Right there in that moment, he took it from a sinner to a saint. Right there in that moment, he took it from one who was corrupt and defiled and polluted with sin. He washed him and he cleansed him and he made him whole. Right there in that moment. But there were some scribes sitting around and they said, oh, if he had got saved, he wouldn't still be doing what he's doing. Oh, if he had got saved, if he really had gotten saved, he'd be doing something different. Can I tell you something this morning? I don't know how it was with you, but whenever God saved me, he saved me to the uttermost. There were some things in my life in that moment that God set me free from. But there have been some things along the way, Brother Dan, that God has given me liberty over. Amen? There's some things, my friend, that God had to work out in my life. There's some things, praise God, that I had to speak to in the name of Jesus on the power of the Word of God that said, loose me and let me go. Amen? Because I'm a child of God. Hey, I'm a child of God. I'm washed in the blood of Jesus. My name's in the Lamb's book of life. Bless God, I belong to him. Yes. You have no authority in my life anymore, devil. You got to let me go in Jesus' name. Yes. I'm talking to somebody this morning. Bless God, you need to tell the devil right now. Whatever foul spirits come up out of hell and come against you and took a hold of your mind and brought you low in a place where the devil's built up a stronghold in the name of Jesus this morning, in the power of the Word of God, loose them and let them go. Bless God, it turned into one of them kind of services. Somebody else to the Lord that had a need. I just wonder, like that, and I'm just dumb enough to believe that there's somebody in the house of the Lord that's got a need today. Your need brought you to the house of the Lord.
Amen.
And here's the thing about it. You may not even know you had a need until you got to the house of the Lord. And then God opened up your eyes and he showed you who you are and who he is. But God's desire is not to leave you in that place. God's desire is to liberate you and to bring you out and to set you free, to save your soul and to write your name down in the Lamb's book of life.